हेलो हेलो हेलो, लवली जीवा, लवली जीवा, नो
नो, यू हैव टू सीम टू केयर, यू हैव टू सीम टू बी, नो नो, आई जस्ट वांट टू बी सीन देयर, यस
यू गेट द ऑडियो, लवली लवली, ऑलराइट, वी आर गेटिंग कमेंट्री फाइनली बॉयज. सो ऑन द कमेंट्री बॉक्स नाउ वी हैव प्रशांत, नवीन एंड अजीत, एंड आई एम गोना गिव इट टू अजीत टू साउंड न्यूट्रल.
गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल, मुराद जीवा रनिंग इन Around the over the wicket, but that one has slipped down the leg. It's been declared a wide. An interesting start to the game. Some of us were absent, so from about 40 for one, Concordia have slipped to 77 for six. Centurions. In comes Murad. That's a full-length ball, but that's been hit beautifully by Charan, skipper Charan of Centurions, and he's comfortably cleared long on. That's a wonderful six run.
Murad from ECN, he always comes back with the Jeeva Jeegs. Let's hope he gives back the batsman the wicket.
Well, just a quick summary on rundown. It's a fantastic, beautiful day out here. We've got under 13, under 11s playing the finale. We've got a Lager class of finale happening around here. There comes Murad. Oh, that's a good bouncer from Murad. Good one, Murad. So basically, the opener was thrashing all around Yanavel, and then it was an amazing comeback. They brought in Manjit, a good spinner, who almost got a couple of wickets that over and fiddled one. And then it's always been Jeeva Shah. Like, what, four wickets? Three in the same over?
Wow, I think we seem to have missed a very eventful period of play. But nonetheless, indeed, it has been working out for the best if you are a Kiwi fan. But if you were to look at this, I think Centurions have enough on the board at the halfway mark. So at 86 for 7, they have enough runs on the board that they could still consolidate for a couple of overs. And then if they were to pick up scoring from that point on, a 140 plus score looks possible. In comes Ajay, who's running in left arm around the wicket. That's on the length and that's been blocked to Murad, who's fielding at point.
Having played with Centurions in Esther class, I think Fayazi and Charan, they're good batsmen who can consolidate and as well as hit at the end of the innings. So it's important for Kiwi to take a wicket right now or else contain. It was good fielding by Sundar.
Yeah, Sundar is one of our better fielders. The catch that he took for the last wicket was quite amazing. It was just travelling around the point area and then it was an amazing catch that Sundar took in. I think Centurions have got like really, really good batting unit. They played Nishant really down the order to stabilise a little bit as well. But as Prashant said, that's when the commentator's curse has jinxed it. We've got Fayazi out. Richard takes a catch. This is amazing for Kiwi today.
Like I said, Fayazi, if you take Fayazi's wicket, then it's difficult chances for Centurions now. But I hope they have batting yet. Charan is there. If somebody stays with Charan, then Charan can turn the tables upside down again.
It's quite possible. Both the teams that's playing the finale today are quite capable teams, and that's one of the reasons why they are in the finale. It's really, really amazing to see how the weather has changed overall. We suspected around like what 40% of rainfall, 80% was yesterday, but it just turns out to be like an amazing weather out here. So whoever is watching on the live stream, if you guys want to catch up some really, really good cricket on field, come over. Kiwave at Sports Park, the Eendracht is open for all of you guys to come visit. An amazing game now, and there's going to be QPL finale right after this.
So, the new batsman is Rakesh, right-handed. He's going to face Ajay, coming left arm over the wicket. This is a good chance for Kiwi to wrap up the innings, but Centurions would want to just hang in. They have the skipper Charan on one side. In comes Ajay, left arm over the wicket. That's a short of length ball targeting the batsman's midriff. It's been blocked back to the bowler.
Yeah, it's going to be really, really interesting. They were supposed to have a Hoofklasa promotion match yesterday for Centurion. So they have topped the Esterklasa this year. That already shows us the quality of the competition that we're going to visit from now on, or what is happening from the beginning. Ajay runs in. That's a good ball, almost missing the bat.
Indeed. I think Ajay has switched over to bowling a bit of a two-card or a three-card trick, where you see one targeting the midriff and the next one all the way up. This was almost a Yorker length delivery, wide of off-stick. Rakesh threw the kitchen sink at it, but yeah, it was wide enough that it would not threaten the stumps. Under a bit of pressure, but this Centurion team is very, very strong. In comes Ajay, left arm over. That's again another Yorker length delivery, but that's been played out to extra cover region where Sundar cleans up. That's the end of the over. That was a maiden wicket from Ajay. Again, a very, very eventful over. So 86 for 8 at the end of 11 overs.
What an eventful 11 overs it has been. Like, really, when they started off, I think they were going about 10 runs an over. The first over went for like 12. The second over round of the mark was like 21 for no loss. They opened in Yanavel. The left-handed batsman kind of sent one outside the park a couple of times. And from that stage to recover and put them back on pressure to 86 for 8, that's amazing. That shows the quality of cricket that is being played. There comes Murad Jiva, and who is now proudly known as Jigs Jiva. Jigs Jiva, in his fourth over, he has given 14 runs and he has picked four crucial wickets. There, Murad comes running in. That's a good bowling. Good bowling to Charan. Charan, their skipper, is quite a very capable batsman. I mean, the match can swing anyways with Charan batting on. So it's going to be really interesting to see how it goes.
All right. Murad is ready at the top of his mark. He's running in. Right arm over. That's a length ball that Charan has swung, but that's gone high up in the air towards midwicket. But it falls between three fielders around the midwicket position in the circle.
That's exactly why calling is important, isn't it, Ajay? Three fielders running in towards the ball. The ball was quite in air. It's sun hitting towards them. Not an easy thing, but the ball falls right in between three people.
Indeed, probably the fielder that was coming in had the best chance rather than the fielder that was going back from short mid-wicket or the fielder that was coming across from square leg. But nonetheless, the field on the off has been beefed up with two short extra covers. In comes Jiva, right arm over. That's hit off the splice. Rakesh has hit it to Ashish at point. And with this, Murad has completed a fiver. Charan, who's on the non-strikers, has in fact thrown the bat down in a bit of disgust, seeing the way his team is falling down.
Five wicket haul for Murad. Can you keep him out of the field wherever he plays? Is either the best fielder that you find on the day, or is the best bowler that you find on the day? Is it all done, or is it going to be the best batsman of the day as well? So they're 9 wickets down. They have the last batsman in, Dharmender Singh, coming in. And our cameraman Prashi is quite busy in getting them all captured. Such a lovely day. Beautiful game. Maninder is quite happy and proud about it, showing his arms for those 9 wickets that they've taken. That's Jigs Jiva for us.
Now, the new man coming in, Dharam, is no mug with the bat. We've played with him previously and we know a bit more about what he can do. It's mainly about whether somebody can talk to him and keep him grounded, because we definitely know he can block the remaining overs out. Well, Charan would probably chance his arm every now and then. But it's going to be a very tough challenge, because with about 7.5 overs left in the game, Centurions would want to still make use of these balls, maybe get to a score of around 120, and that would still make it a very competitive game. Right then, he's ready with his guard, Dharam. He's ready to face Murad coming in. Right arm over the wicket. That's a good length delivery, and it's been blocked back to the bowler. He seems to be showing a bit of patience here.
Yeah, that's pretty good resistance for the first ball coming in, not trying to whack away and finish it off. So that's some good conversations happening down there. But interestingly, over the last three games that's been played here, yesterday and today, they've all been kind of low scoring. 63, 112. 86. Oh, that's a flipping slow ball. Lovely LBW. 6 wickets down the line. Jigs Jiva doing his digs. That's an amazing thing from QWave. 87 all-out Centurions. We'll be back soon.
That was an interesting counter play, because having sort of set him up with a good length delivery to start off, that was a beautiful slower ball. And it looks like Dharam was across in front of the sticks and he missed a hike to the leg and he was pinned right in front. Today we have two umpires. So it looks like Kiwi have wrapped up the innings and they are going to now chase down about 88. And well, it could still be a very interesting sort of a game under sunny skies where the pitch has nicely warmed up. So in the final of the LPT20 so far, Kiwi seem to have the upper hand as they have gotten out their opponent Centurions for 87. You know, in some cultures, especially if you're Australian, 87 is considered a very unlucky number because it's 13 short of 100. But will this prove to be somewhat lucky for Kiwi? I think we'll see this after the break. Meanwhile, we'll have a short word with Murad, the man of the moment.
Oh, Murad, can we keep you away? Can we keep you away? You know what, I'm going to take this on me again. Every time I curse you, you fucking show up there, boy. You fucking show up there. How was it? 6 wickets?
Yeah, it was interesting the way they started. So, we had to do something to get the game back. Otherwise, what would happen is they would have run away with the total. And it's always finals, so whenever there's a big game, I try and put my hand up, whether it's bowling, batting, mostly fielding. So I just backed myself and I went for it.
Lovely, Jeeva. Lovely. We were missing the Jigs Jeeva show, though. Well, that wasn't coming up as well as what it was.
I think that's mostly copyrighted for ECN now. I'm going to reserve it there.
The game is done. Cheers, guys. Make sure that you guys finish it on the high.
Yes, for sure. Thank you, guys.
Hey, bud.
called me.
So, all right, we are ready to resume after the break with So in this case, we are awaiting the batters. Centurions are eager to get it underway as they don't want to lose any steam. The umpires are acknowledging the scorers. Meanwhile, we have the two batters walking out from Kivif. This is going to be an interesting short chase, one way or the other. We don't see this going the distance because with a target of 88, it's going to be ending within the 20 over, is the expectation. We have the captain, Charan, who's been a very big influence for Centurions this season.
Yeah, I think 88 is not a 20 over game, is it? They're possibly going to go for wickets, and they'll have to go for wickets. The only way that they can really make a game out here is making sure that they can get those 10 wickets in whatever limited time as possible. So it's going to be super important on the way they maintain their body language. It's going to be super important to stay positive in this moment. Ashish Arora is taking strike for Kiviv. I think Ashish Arora is someone that they'll remember for his 76 at their home ground earlier in the league stages, which we won comfortably. So it's going to be fun. And we've got Captain Maninder on the other side. And Charan is going to open the bowling for them.
So I'm your ball-by-ball summarizer, Ajit, and we have Naveen to add a bit of color. The two batsmen are conferring in the middle. Probably it's all about not underestimating how good the bowling and the fielding of Centurions will be and getting off a steady start. Maybe build a small platform, something like 24 no loss, 25 for no loss, and from then on build a proper serious chase. Some small changes to the field. Charan has pushed mid-on and mid-off back all the way to the fence. You have a deep cover. In comes Charan, right arm over the wicket. That's a beautiful swinging delivery, but it was too wide to start off. So it's been declared the wide by umpire.
That's going to be fun. We've got a couple of kids and Richard's wife all the way to watch him. You probably missed a lot. He took some amazing catches. That's another good ball. This is a proper one. The first dot. So Ajay, is it your bat that Ashish Arora is using? What's the deal there? You've sent your bat to the top order batsman out there. It's more like, Ajay, I've done my bit with bowling, so it's either I'm scoring or my bat is scoring.
Fair enough. We have Ajay, who had a beautiful effort with the ball earlier, and he looks like his bat is now with the opening batsman. It looks like, you know, there are famous stories. Before we go there, Charan, once more right arm over the wicket. This is a full ball. He's allowing the ball to swing. He's doing everything in his power to make sure the batsman gets off or maybe nicks off. We have a gully, a close-in catching point, and a second slip. First 1.5 second slip. Charan doesn't run in much, Naveen.
Yeah, I've seen him over a few matches, but he's one of the best bowlers that I've seen who can consistently bowl what he wants to do. So there's a big difference between what comes out of him and what he wants to do, right? And Charan is someone who can accurately do what he wants to do. And I've seen him bowl like 8-10 overs on a trot in Esta Classic games. So it's going to be very interesting. They're going to be heavily reliant on Charan. But also Kiwi will know that they'll have to see him through.
Indeed. With a smallish total, they have the, let's say, the freedom to see him out. Centurions are very aggressive in their fielding setup currently, and they have kept the first 5 balls to no runs. Well, there was a wide to begin with, but no runs off the bat. And Charan has been equally good with his lengths, except for that first ball.
I like the positivity in the Centurions camp, really coming around, really making sure they're shouting for what it is. That's a good ball, beat in the bat. There's a lot of things with Ashish, but the moment anything that falls in his zone and if he connects, that's when it's going to be the best of the lot that we can see.
Indeed. That's the end of the first over. While the teams change over for the beginning of the second over, it's an interesting approach from Ashish, who, well, as Naveen correctly said, if something is right up in his half, he might swing clean, and if he connects, they usually go far. So Ganga, who's actually Gurnam Singh, is going to bowl from the other end. We are sitting on a beautiful, beautiful summer's day. And in this case, Ganga is warming up, throwing the ball to the extra cover fielder. We have the same sort of a setup, a catching gully, a catching point. There's a deepish cover to protect them, and there's a shortest extra cover as well. So a lot of catching fielders in front of the wicket and two behind. There's a mid wicket and a square leg, while you have long on and long off both back to the skipper Maninder, who's taking strike for the first time in this innings. Now then. He's ready to go. In comes Ganga, right arm over. That's a slightly wide ball that's been cut cleanly by Maninder, and that's four. And that's the first runs of the bat for Kiwi in their innings.
That's an amazing boundary. People who have known Maninder over the years, that's one of his strengths. Anything slightly wide outside the off stump, it's going to be getting dispatched. And it's power play, so they can't have more than two fielders out. And it's very interesting that they have chosen long on and long off to be those positions. Interesting strategy. Let's see what's coming up. Gurnam Singh bowls the second one. Pretty much slightly on the length outside a money zone. Driven down towards the long on for a single. So at this moment, Kuviv have got six runs without a wicket. They need 81 more runs. It's still a pretty long game. Ashish Arora has taken strike. That's a good ball. There's a bit of a little bit of varying bounce on this wicket on the other end. You could see that ball really taking a little bit of a steep take towards the keeper. I like the voice from Centurions. It's really keeping them positive. I would really, really like to see a tough competition.
In comes Ganga, right arm over. That's a full length ball. That's exactly what Ashish has been looking for. That's been hoiked to the empty cow corner region. It's just crossed the boundary by the looks of it. Yes, that's another four. So a couple of positive blows for Kiwif. This is what they would look to do in the first 4 overs of this innings by the looks of it. Because we have the threat of Charan and Ganga on both sides. They would probably look to block the ball, which are good, and play positively at those that are in their half and that can indeed be scored off. Because we are in the power play still. Lot of empty gaps in the field. Lot of empty space to exploit if you're looking for runs. A change now. With mid-wicket moving back to mid-off, and now a deep cow corner for Ashish, and long-off remains in place.
I think it's really important for them to vary their length and keep the pace up. Gurnam is kind of clever. He's not giving any pace to the batsman. But he's still been dispatched for a couple of boundaries purely because he hit the wrong line ones and the wrong length ones. So that shows you how good the batting as well is. They're just going to sit back and wait because it's a low score. And the moment anything that falls on this zone, anything away, is going to be dispatched out. That's a very good shot towards the backward point. Lofted one goes to the boundary. That's exactly what I've been telling. Anything on the outside of the off stump towards Maninder, this is going to be the result.
This is a big over for Kiwif. Three boundaries have come off it. And it must be said, I think Kiwi would be very happy with the way they've begun by, you know, taking about 14 runs of the first three overs. Indeed. It's 14 for no loss after two. And it's going to be an interesting sort of a situation because how will Centurions play this? You know, it's very clear this game might not last the distance. Will they bowl out their best bowler, somebody like Charan, in one spell? With the sun baking down on the field is completely dried out. There's a lot of value for ground shots as well. So this is a very interesting combination as to how probably Centurions would want to handle it. They would definitely would have welcomed another 12, 20 runs. But now having made a middling sort of a total, they'll want to make breakthroughs, right? So Ashish among the two batsmen has looked the most uncomfortable. Maninder is looking comfortable there. He's gotten a couple of hitting balls. Now then, Charan is ready to start the new over.
Yeah, the thing with Ashish is he never looks comfortable, but he looks beautiful when he hits those big ones out, and that's predominantly what Ashish is. Most of the times when you keep watching Ashish, it doesn't sound like what is he going to do. But some of the things on his zone, it's just going to make it really, really nice. That was an interesting thought process you had, Ajit. Are they going to ball out Charan? I think they should.
Right. A slower ball from Charan, but I think he's overcooked it. And that's gone for a one bounce four. So it was a very comfortable hip high full toss for Ashish, and he's unlikely to miss out on this. Charan is probably trying to experiment a bit because he knows, you know, the previous ball we saw, it was a full pitched up ball that was swinging away. Ashish swung himself off his feet literally through the kitchen sink, as they said it. But he couldn't connect. But this one, now it remains to be seen if Ashish will now play a waiting game. In comes Charan over the wicket. That's the next same foolish ball that's swinging away, and Ashish swings at it but misses.
Waiting game from Ashish is kind of an over expectation at this point in time. This dude has a couple of things that he does. He does it well, and he does it quite consistently. Charan comes running in. It's on the zone. That's gone. Gone like a mile. It's about 200 kilometers from here. Somebody will have to find a new ball, I assume.
Well, that was a smashing shot, no doubt. But I'm now thinking back. Is it one of the biggest sixes I've witnessed from this end? Batting from the pavilion end, we've seen some big shots. But from the other end, from the hockey ground end, it looks... Yeah, he's comfortably hit the ball all the way to the bleachers. Or yes, it's gone to the training ground. It's gone to the two training nets. It's one of the biggest sixes I've witnessed. And it was sort of swung from across. So it was not a straight hit.
Where do you set fielding for that, Ajit? Really, where do you set fielding for those shots, man? Doesn't matter how many and where they are. Now they're moving the slip away. Kind of quite confident that the ball isn't going to take any edges from this moment. I was kind of cleverly bowled down the leg, or kind of Yorker length, well defended by Ashish. He knows he's got those runs already.
In any case, it looks like there's a little bit of a leg trap set. There is a backward square leg ready. In comes Charan over the wicket. Again, another foolish ball. His default, or the obvious delivery from Charan, which is always pitched up, swinging away. This one has been cleverly blocked by Ashish.
So after 3 overs, 25 runs for no loss. Charan has bowled 2 overs, just gave 11 runs. The experience was clearly seen after that six. He moved the field, had a square leg. He made sure that he's setting up the bowler for, you know, kind of a bounce deliveries, and then bowled 2 full deliveries, foxing the batsman. It was well negotiated by Ashish. Good defense. With Maninder and Ashish going at this rate, it's going to be really interesting. But also, we have 3 more overs of power play. They've got a new bowler in, I assume.
Harshad is the new bowler who's looking to mark his run-up, and he's having a chat with the skipper about the field placements. They're talking about the deep point boundary because both the boundaries by skipper Maninder were through the backward point third man region. Of course, they were off shorter balls, but looks like there may be a change of guard here. Because when we look at the field, there's a deep point and there's a traditional catching point. We have a mid-wicket, mid-on and mid-off, interestingly. So this means they're confident of not bowling any of the balls up in the, you know, foolish length zone. We have an extra cover catching and a slip catching.
I've seen Harshad in a couple of games. He is someone who is consistent. He can just bowl line and length quite consistently. But are you thinking that they're missing a trick of bowling a slow bowler in? They've seen the ground. They've seen their first couple of wickets was generated by a slow bowler who brought in. I'm still thinking Centurions are probably missing a trick by not bowling a spinner up.
Interesting. In comes Harshad, right arm over. That's a short of length delivery that Maninder has really gone hard at it. The field right mid wicket waits under it and pouches it comfortably. This was a good catch. So the change of bowling has clearly worked. So Vignesh has taken the catch of the bowling of Harshad, and Kiwi have lost their first wicket. So at 25 for one, they have the platform, Naveen.
Well, yeah, I definitely think the platform is in. But losing the skipper, that's going to be something hard to digest. That being said, the batting lineup is quite deep. They bat even as late as number 11. So both the teams know it. As I said at the beginning, the quality of both the teams are very similar. And due credit, both teams deserve to play the finale at this point in time. So Centurions will have some hope at this point in time now that they've picked Maninder, who's someone who could have finished the game in the next 3 hours.
Indeed, this is a very critical breakthrough, but they still have Ashish to contend with. Vasant is the number 3 who's walked in. The new batsman will be on the non-striker's end as the batsman had crossed over. So Ashish will be facing Harshad. Ready at the top of his mark. In comes Harshad, right arm over. A beautiful, almost Yorker length delivery that's been blocked back by Ashish. There was an attempt at a shy, and Ashish is like, my stumps are open.
Yeah, Harshad is really, really smart. He has done it quite often. He's got the wicket. He's going to be highly confident of what he wants to deliver. I'm sure he's going to be one of the hopeful persons for Centurions to make sure that it is on the track. That's another good ball. It has been hit really well by Ashish. This hasn't gone that far, but it is a beautiful 6.
Indeed, so he's showing his full range here, Ashish. The previous one was slogged across and hit towards, let's say, deep long on. This one was hit through the line off a horizontal bat nonetheless, but it traveled quite a distance. So another 6. And, you know, the more of these that he's able to get in, the quicker Kiwi were supposed to, let's say, get to half the mark, they would feel that much comfortable. At one down and with about 2 more overs of the par play, in comes Harshad. That's another length ball, but Ashish was sort of ready for it by the looks of it, and he's hit it over his favorite cow corner.
I think Ashish is in no mood to wait. He just wants to finish the game probably in the next couple of overs. Look at the range that he has done. He has done one cross bat for about really 20 kilometers away or so on and so forth. One on the offside and the very next ball again. I think Harshad is running out of options. He probably seemed very confident after the first wicket, but there's a lot of reset thinking that needs to happen at this point in time.
Indeed. But with a couple more balls left in this over to negotiate, it's going to be interesting what Harshad is planning to do. Have they taken a leaf out of what you've been saying, Naveen? And they're going to probably bowl somebody slower in one of the upcoming overs.
Well, for a moment, I thought that's what they should have done earlier. But then the first wicket fall, I was like, commentators, come on. What do you know about what's happening right at that moment? But that was another wicket. Harshad comes back, strikes hard. That shows you the quality of the bowler at this point in time. There's a lot of excitement in the Centurions camp. After 2 big blows, they've taken a good wicket. Now, Qwave are at 37 for 2.
I think he rolled his finger over that one. It came on a bit slower off the pitch than Ashish had expected. Therefore, he played the shot a little earlier than he would have wanted. Chipped it straight back to the bowler. But that was an excellent caught and bowled off his own bowling by Harshad. So, it was well above his head. But he was able to comfortably jump and take a very important catch for his team.
I think that's very well said, right? He rolled his fingers. The ball was slow. The ball was in the length. That's one of the reasons why I still think that they should bowl a spinner in. And then they should try and see what it is. But are they going to take our advice? That's the most critical question to know for, right? The new batsman walking in. Still need to figure out who that is. Is that Richie? That's what it looks like. But we need to give it a moment to know who it is. Richard Fernandez takes guard. He had a busy day wicket keeping. Took about 5 catches. Was helping Murad achieve a 6 for. Pretty stable batsmen, Richie and Vasant. Hopefully, they'll be applying themselves and making sure they take it down the line.
All right. While we wait for the next ball, we see some people from the QPL finals already arriving. In comes Harshad, right arm over. That's a beautiful length ball that's just been let go by Richie. That's the end of another very eventful over. So at 37 for 2 after just 4 overs, Kiwi would consider themselves ahead in the game because the target is just 51 runs away. But 51 runs is plenty of time to cause a little bit of a panic in the batting. If they were to get a couple more breakthroughs right away, sort of expose the middle order of Kiwis, they are giving themselves a good chance, the Centurions. And the ball is in the very capable hands of the skipper, Charani. I think Charan is going to go all out. He's going to bowl himself out, give himself a chance.
By far, Charan is the best bowler. 2 overs, 11 runs. And that's a shot from Vasant. Let's see where it goes. It's a boundary! That's a boundary! That's definitely on the six lines. Let's wait for the umpire's call at this point in time. We'll have to wait for the fielder to give his call. We're going to take the fielder's strength at this point in time and give it a single.
That was a wonderful piece of fielding. The fielder took the ball, but when he realized he was about to cross over, he threw the ball at his compatriot, who was running in from long on, and thereby saving 5 runs for his team. It could have been considered a close, this thing. It could have been considered a very close event, because he had a good chance of also taking the ball and taking another wicket for his captain. This is an interesting approach from Kiwis, because, well, having put up a very decent total on the board, they seem to still take a strong approach.
That was an interesting feeling. This is exactly why cameras are going to be really important in the future, to really, really know what it is. It was a masterpiece fielding for Fayazi. Could have very well been one of the best catches and the one that was needed on time. There's a lot of buzz that's happening on the field with Charan setting up a lot of differences. Perhaps he thinks he's seen Richie Yanef. What do you think?
I think there are not a lot of secrets between these two teams when it comes to their playing strengths. In comes Charan. That's a good length delivery, his bread and butter ball, as they say. But that, even though it was full up, was swinging too much and has been declared a wide. The ball goes back to Charan. Richard had an interesting go at it as well, but I think it was in his arc. So it must be said, in comes Charan. Again, beautiful ball on the length, drawing Richard forward and moving away from him to beat him neck and crop.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting now. Two new batsmen, both of them together have faced 4 balls. Richard has faced 3 balls and 3 dots. It's really important for them to get their eye in and apply themselves. Probably Centurions are going to look into this as an opportunity to split things out. Good outswing delivery, well watched by Richie, good leave.
Indeed, they have enough time that they could consolidate for an over or two, because the total is not too far away. And they have enough depth in the batting, so one thing is to not think that way, the other is to be take comfort from it. That was a shortish ball, but that was hitting Richie in the midriff. I think there was an excitement from Captain Charan, because he turned back to appeal. That's an instinct. I would put it down to instinct rather than anything more logical.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Trying to try those legs. But then he's kind of confident. He's got like 4 dot balls. Richie would be feeling like, geez, why did I miss it? Should have been down to the park. There it goes. Well done by Richie there. Just negotiating the swing pretty much well. That's at the end of the over. 39 runs for 2 wickets.
So, interestingly, there was a deep extra cover placed when Richard was on strike. So, as Naveen was talking, it looks like they know each other's strengths and weaknesses, and they're able to make use of it. Therefore, knowing that Richard is good, both of the front and the back foot through the covers, there was a deep extra cover put in place, and maybe trying to entice him to hit out, because the cover was left open to see if he can hit out and give a catch to the deep fielder.
Well, there's not a lot of secrets, as you said, between these two teams, but I don't know how much of Vasant have they known. It's going to be really interesting to see what it is. This dude has got 3 T20 hundreds. He's been one of our best batsmen in and out for pretty much this season, and a pretty classical, the technique that you see from him and the way that he bats out, you would really love to get into the batting zone of what he wants to do.
All right. So Harshad started off with a slightly back of length delivery that was pushed to point. Interesting to see what Harshad would come up with. In he comes, right arm over. That's a beautiful length delivery that was swinging enough. And Vasant, as they say, put the kitchen sink at it, threw it literally, and that's what happens, right? So when you slash this, you slash hard. That's what he did.
That's exactly what Vasant does. It's no doubt. There's no two minds. He just slashes his heart. It's either straight down or it's going to be on what behind boundaries are. The runs haven't come that great, but we'll take whatever it comes.
Indeed. Next ball is again short of length, but it was in the hitting zone for Vasant, and there was no deep fielder in cover, and the ball comfortably goes to the boundary, well in front of square actually. So it looks like Vasant is able to both judge the pace as well as the length that Harshad is bowling. This calls for a little bit of a change of thought from Centurions here.
Yeah, there's no one zone for Vasant. That's the most important thing. It's not like don't give this, don't do that. He's a pretty sound technical batsman. So it's going to be really interesting on the way Centurions are going to come back. Really well thought by Harshad. Good defense by Vasant as well. We are more than half the mark at this point in time, 47.
All right, having reached, at least made more than half the runs required, with only one wicket down, definitely we are ahead in this game, and because we are only in the... they have lost two indeed, both the openers are out. In comes Harshad. That's another length ball that Vasant looks to bunt and run into the covers, but the extra cover fielder is very active. That won't be a run.
Well, Harshad has been really good. He's gone for two sixes last over. He's gone for two boundaries this over. But he has recovered time and again. He's given only 20 runs. Quite a lot. But then it's T20 at the end of the day. But he's taken two crucial wickets. He's taken both the openers away from the equation.
Indeed. Can he get one more breakthrough for his team? Waiting at the top of his mark. He's running in. That's a full length delivery, but the field is set as such, and that's been bunted to extra cover by Vasant. That ends another very eventful over, two boundaries of that over.
At the end of six overs, Kiwis have scored 47 runs, they've lost two wickets. That's the end of the power play. And about the same mark, Centurions were close to about 40 runs as well, and they haven't had lost a wicket at that point in time. So it's going to be really interesting to see how the game is going to shape from now. Now that they have five fielders outside the circle. But they're still going with Charan finishing up his over.
All right. So Charan will be throwing his lot in right away. He's now coming into bowl. Or he will be bowling the last of his overs in this game. He's talking to a colleague. He's trying to get some ideas from him. Interestingly, with Richard on strike, the deep extra cover comes out. Long on and long off have been posted. There has been a straightish long on, long off. The keeper has come up. We know that Charan doesn't have too much of pace, but what he boasts of is more of a control over the ball. So it's going to be an interesting challenge for the keeper with all the swing.
That's an interesting thought. Charan is a good swing bowler. They've got keeper up, and they've got a batsman there who doesn't really stay out of his crease to negotiate it. Yeah, this is going to be interesting. We'll see how the keeper is going to negotiate everything around from the blind spot.
Another beautiful ball by Charan. That amazing control that he has over line and length. You would not do much with that ball. You would have to go back and block or come just a little bit ahead and then block. So it's just in that in-between length, which can either be played off the back or the front foot. But we know he's capable of this. So, but are Kiwis batters aware that this is his last over?
That's exactly what I was trying to say as well, Ajit. He's got five more deliveries. And all you need is to negotiate him. And then it's going to rip open apart what the next line of bowlers for Centurions are. Not underestimating them. They've got like really, really good deep bowling unit as well. But I don't think anybody is going to be as good as Charan though.
Indeed. And we know that they have a spinner as well in their lineup. So we are looking forward to what the next changes will be. Meanwhile, in comes Charan. That's that again deadly length. But this has been bunted in front of cover. And before the throw can be returned and run out affected, the batsman has run in his bat. So Vasant is safe. It must be said he's run another half a length of a pitch away again. But that's all right. You know, it's a tight single. Now, Richard, I would have backed to actually play this over out. But Vasant seemed to be a very sensible batsman as well. And they know where they are, I'm sure, the Kiwis batsman.
I think that single is important. It has rotated the strike. It has put pressure on the opposition. But also, is it really needed at this moment, that quick one? But Yeah, apparently both of these batsmen know each other well. The calling was great, and they were able to negotiate. Charan runs in. Vasant drives one straight down towards the long off region for a single. There's going to be a good couple of singles, and this is all. This is pretty sensible batting from Kiviv. All they need to do is to get a couple of singles here and there, and the longer they bat, the game is theirs.
Indeed. With the current run rate, if they bat past the 12th or the 13th over mark, you'd see the total being overhauled. And with Richie and Vasant, you have a couple of very sensible, level-headed blokes at the crease. Let's see what happens. In comes Charan. That's a little bit shorter compared to what Charan bowls, and that's been cut behind point. But the point fielder is very rapid, and the ball has been fielded. So this has brought the 50 up for Kiviv. Nonetheless, Charan is ready to go. In he comes, another length delivery. The stumps have been disturbed, but by the looks of it, it's from the keeper's hands because there is absolutely no excitement from anybody involved. Looks like everybody knows what happened there. All right. This means Charan has his last ball to go.
Well, what is the rule there when the keeper dislodges the stumps when the ball is in progress? Was the ball in progress, actually?
Ball is
lovely, lovely. Yeah. I still think the change of bringing the keeper up hasn't worked really well in their favor. They've given close to about 5 singles in this over, and Charan had to bring down his pace and negotiate on a swing. Not sure if that's the smart move.
No, I think there was some other thought process. We have one of our colleagues who want to chime in. I think he has got onto what the thought process is, actually.
Yeah, actually, I wanted to comment on the keeper disturbing the stumps when the ball is in progress. In that case, if a clean ball happens, then it won't be given out. You know, so that's the only consequence that I see.
What if one of the stumps is clear and cleanly knocked out? This is an interesting thought process, because in a run-out situation...
Interesting other comments coming in saying it should have been called a no ball. So I don't know what it is going to be. We'll have to run the rule books down. But that's again, as a keeper, I think he would have learned his lesson at this point. I'm not to lodge it even before he collects the ball at this point in time. They've got a bowling change. And the QF have got 51 already.
No, after the ball was delivered. The bales were disturbed. Nay, later, after. So we have the competition leader from KNCB here with us. He's brought a very interesting point to bear that should have been called a no ball, because the stumps were apparently broken before the ball reached the batsman. That means the keeper's gloves actually crossed or contacted with the stumps, which in theory is a no ball.
That's true. But also, to be in all fairness for the umpires, it's really, really difficult to spot it. As the batsmen are blinding them, the squalor umpire had to look into it, and the technology will have to support so much. Just in all fairness, it's not as easy as how we think it is. And they've done an exciting, really good job over the last 30-plus overs.
In comes Dharam, new bowler, right arm over. He starts off with a beautiful length ball. It looked like it may have actually contacted pad first or bat first from... Behind the sticks, it's a bit difficult to call, but the umpire is happy to give that not out. So,
I had a huge noise from the bat. Looks like bat first to me, but I'm kind of behind the batsman, so there's no way I could really call it out. That was a good decision by the umpire, not giving down the LBW. The arm runs in. That's a good shot by Vasant. There's no fielders out there. Hopefully that's a six, and we're waiting for the fielder to go to Osgood. We're still waiting for the umpires to see what the decision is going to be, and that's been called as boundary. That's a flipping good shot by Vasant Sagar.
Indeed, he shows his class. Having sort of beaten for pace, or the lack of it in the first ball, he's adjusted enough to see that there's a lot of gap on the leg side. That was flicked beautifully off his pads, out to deep mid-wicket fence for a boundary.
They're going to have 5 fielders out, and where are those 5 fielders?
We seem to have missed a pivotal piece of play. We apologize because there are some technical difficulties. But I can tell you Vasant Sekar has been dismissed. It was a short of length delivery from Dharam. Again, a slowish one. And in trying to hit him across, he was sort of beaten due to the lack of pace. And the ball went straight up in the air towards long off, where skipper Charan was camped to the right side of the side screen, took a comfortable catch. So another breakthrough for Centurions. Richard is in place and Kumaran walks to replace Vasant. This is another big hitter of the ball, and if he keeps on, it's very clear that Kiwi have done a positive move here by sending in Kumaran. It's sort of his traditional place to play, but if Richie can hold one end and Kumaran can go hard at the ball, which he's meant to. A very interesting field. Charan is still camped just on the right-hand side of the side screen. It's a very interesting field position from him. Meanwhile, in comes Dharan, bowling to Richie. Right arm over. That's beautifully played off the back foot, but straight to the bowler. No run. Dharam is going back. There's still a lot of chatter on the field from Centurions. They've clearly not given up on this yet. There is a short third man at traditional point. An extra cover, a mid-off, and a deep man who's sort of straight at the wicket, in the deep. Another length ball that's been blocked, but it's been picked up quickly by a running in extra cover, no run there. Apart from that, we have a mid-wicket and a deep mid-wicket.
Sorry for the technical difficulties that we're facing. We're trying out a new camera today and seems to go to sleep mode once in a while. While we work on that, I think Richie is negotiating it really, really well. He's played 12 balls. He has understood the situation, and the commentator's curse kicks in again. As I say, he understood the situation, goes for a flyer, misses a couple of stumps there. And at the end of the over, we've got 55 runs, 4 wickets, and Centurions are pumped up to see what exciting things can this break open.
Very interesting to see that somehow Kiwi have given up 2 wickets in this over. Completely uncalled for, given the way they were batting in the last couple of overs. There seemed to be a sense of calm which suddenly went away. I would say a bit of commentator's curse, and I would blame my colleague Naveen for that. And they are giving Centurions a look in this game. 55 for 4 after 8 overs. Kiwi was still comfortably ahead because the number of runs required is about 32. But if you remember what happened in the second semi-final, Naveen, would you like to tell us what happened in yesterday's QQPL second semi-final?
I'm sure Ajit wants to rub it into me. For the scenario that we were in for Titans versus Thrashers in yesterday's semi-finals, we were close about 81 runs for 3 wickets, and then we lost the remaining 5 in a quick sting. But that being said, if you remember the batters batting out there, they scored those 75 runs as well, Ajit.
Interestingly, it's the same two batsmen who had taken his team, Titans, within the QPL to the same sort of a position. Is it a redemption chance, we wonder? Because it's the same two players, Kumaran who got out and Manjeet, who was there when the collapse started.
It's no fun. Both of us play for the same team, Ajit, at the end of the day. But I think so they would have learned the lessons. It's really good that it happened yesterday, right? So the memories are in fresh and they're going to execute it really well. But that being said, I still think Kiwi is super positive out there. 55 runs, right, not about even 10 overs mark. It's just 8 overs, 55. There's 12 more overs to go. They're comfortably in the driving seat. They just need to apply it. It was an excellent bowling with Dharam. He's got his laugh there. He's hopeful that Centurions would be able to pull something out.
Indeed. Why I say they've thrown the game open a little bit is because there are now 2 batsmen at the crease, neither of whom has placed a single ball. And it'll take them a couple of balls to get the measure of the pitch. And we know, as a team that had topped the Erste Class League, this Centurions team cannot be taken for granted. And Harshad has switched ends. He's coming in from right arm over from the pavilion end. In he comes. That's a good length delivery, a pacey one. And it's been blocked back to him by Kumaran off the back foot. It's going to be interesting now because Harshad is back on his mark.
Oh, I have no doubt that these guys are going to end for the longer run. It's going to be an exciting game. It's going to be quite watchful. That's very well batted by Kumaran. Down the leg, there's a bit of a mix-up on the calling. Is that a run-out? That's a run-out. Manjeet goes without facing a ball. it's an inevitable pressure that Kiwi West put on themselves at this point in time. It's going to be interesting now. As Ajit said, the gates have been wide open. We lost two wickets in the last over, but two batsmen in who haven't played a single delivery. And we see Manjit walking without facing any delivery being run out. What's going to happen, Ajit? What is the right thing to do at this point in time?
Well, we have Savneet walking in. And as you rightly pointed, Kiwi have a long batting lineup. It's 32 runs. And 32 runs required in about 11 plus overs. Reminds me of another game from my recent memory. But, you know, this means Kiwi was still under pressure. I think that was an unnecessary single. The fielder at square leg was well in. And this was just bunted just short of him. And he was coming in to pick up the ball. That gives him all the advantage. The momentum is on his side. Manjit sort of hesitated for a second, we felt, before he began his run. And that may have cost him his wicket.
I think just well. It's, again, great umpiring, right? The umpiring is on point where they were able to find out the runouts and then really call for it. Savneet, interestingly, is our best player for the decade. He's been with the club for about 10 years, to be honest. And every single time that he has showed up well. And there's a lot of responsibility on his shoulders playing the Lager class of finale at this point in time. Harshad running in. Very well taken for a single by Savneet. Sensible batting out there. Is this going to be the pair to do it?
One hopes so for Kiwi because they'll not want to lose any more wickets, put more pressure on themselves. Because, you know, funny things can happen once the top order is out of the way. Five has already gone. But this was more, as you say, sensible cricket. Just bunted it in front of square on the leg side. There was no fielder there. There's only a long gone well back. But I think this is going to be a game more on the off. You have Captain Charan himself, who's at extra cover. He's pushed long gone all the way back to the fence. In comes Harshad, right arm over. That's again another short of length ball, but this time has been placed behind the square leg fielder comfortably by Kumaran. He wants a second, but Savneet comfortably sends him back, and which is the right thing to do. But on the way down, trying to dive to save his wicket, Kumaran seems to have injured a shoulder. The ball hit his elbow as well, so it's a dual thing. Kumaran seems to be down. They're calling in for a bit of assistance from the Kiwi camp. Maybe they need a bit of a spray to be brought out.
It's been a tough year for Kumaran. He's been kind of injured 6 times in his last 4 months. And he's kind of been known to get injured in various different ways that he could get. It's really unfortunate, but it also shows the commitment of that lad. Been injured 6 times, still coming up every single moment and showing up for the games. So that's a lot of commitment. So I wouldn't be surprised that he takes a spray on his bones, gets up, and then, you know, puts a show there.
Indeed. Skipper Maninder seems to be the one. He was very concerned about how his player is doing. He's the one that come out with a bottle of water and a can of spray. Meanwhile, my co-commentators and the scorer are discussing how many times and in what multiple ways Kumaran has injured himself. But as Naveen rightly pointed out, you can't keep this guy down. He throws himself all the way in, as you could see, literally, both figuratively and literally. And, well, you would always want a guy like this in your team. And we know how destructive he can be when he's batting. Meanwhile, we have competition leader Bart from KNCB who's come in to have a look at the scorecard. While we wait for play resumption of play, Bart, a couple of words. What do you think about the result? What do you think? How do you think this is going to go?
Well, it's going to be a tight match, that's for sure. If it has to be that if Kiviva keeps their nerves, then they should bet it out easily. But you never know, eh? If one or two wickets fall quickly now, we have a challenge on our hands, I think.
That's beautifully summarized. I couldn't have put it better myself. That's about it. Can Kiviv keep their nerve for a couple of hours coming up and maybe bring the target down to about 20 and then it's just a home stretch? Otherwise, if they lose a couple more wickets, it's going to be interesting. Nice to see a lot of members from KNCB board and competition runners and these people also coming to support the game. Now then, the tension resumes with Savneet on strike to face Harshad. In he comes, right arm over. That's a proper length delivery. There is some excitement in that appeal. but it's very clearly seen just a back of Lynn Dillery that's going to comfortably go on top of the stumps. The umpires say no. We have another commentator who's joined us, Puneet. Puneet, would you like to say a few things?
Thank you. It's a nice day for a very wonderful match setup. And it's quite surprising that since yesterday, this field is behaving in a different way. We are seeing bowlers ruling the game. And we've seen two low-scoring T20 games yesterday, two semifinals under QPL. And now we have another one coming in. So looks like even the 80s and 100s are also defensible, you know, in on these pitches. And, you know, speaking from the game, it's actually enjoyable. As a cricket person, I'm really happy that you know, the new format like T20. Now the bowlers are also making their mark. You know, when the T20 format started, you know, we had people saying that bowlers, this is not for the bowlers. It's only the batsman game. And now we are seeing games where the bowlers are also, you know, deciding the game. And you know, T20 is now, you know, is becoming an all-round game.
Meanwhile, the over from Harshad was finished with one single taken, and we have Dharam continuing from the other end. The score has moved on to 59 for 5, and we are in the 10th over.
So there's no pressure on run rate. There's no pressure on scoring rates or anything that has to happen. At this point in time, the opposition will have to figure out a way to really play a mental game out. Artis swinging down the leg, probably a leg by, hits the pad towards the square leg. Yes, the umpire calls it as a leg by, and QA will take the runs any which way as it comes.
Now they've moved on to 60. And Kumaran looked a bit awkward trying to heave it away on the leg, but he was beaten, and the ball clearly impacted with the pad well outside the leg stump. But an interesting passage of play nonetheless, if you are a cricket enthusiast. Because these are tense runs, but as Bart rightly pointed out, if they can bat out another 2 to 3 overs, in comes Dharam. That's a short of length ball, and Savneet is not messing about with that. That's been hit clean and clear of the deep in wicket fielder, right over his head, and a 6.
Well, all I'm hearing from the audience is, that's it, I think. And that's what Savneet does. No wonder that he is our best player for the decade. He's been with us 10 years and quite consistent every single season that he comes out, and irrespective of any team that he plays. Takes the ownership on him again. He did that a couple of games before as well. That's exactly how you do it. You put him for a 6 and then you respect the ball and next ball.
Indeed. The ball that was hit for a 6 was a slightly short of length ball, and with the pace that he operates at, Dharam cannot afford that line and length. And most batsmen would want to go hard at it. So now the score has moved on to 66 for 5. In comes Dharam. That's a foolish ball, but, well, in most games, Savneet would want to do something more interesting than what he just did. But given the conditions here, he's just bunted it to the extra cover fielder, and I'm sure he's happy having already scored a 6.
Well, we said tosses are not important on a shorter format like T20, but how important was the toss today? Maninder winning and choosing to field first.
I would say a very important toss to win, because he knows he can back his bowlers. Cleverly, before the toss, Maninder instructed the cameraman and the interviewers to not ask him what he was going to do. I wonder if this was a ploy or this was, you know, a double-edged thing, because was he not sure or was he always sure what he wanted to do?
I reckon he was flipping a coin. What do we know from here at this point in time? It has worked well. Winning the toss, as much as it's 50% probability on luck, but doing the right decision and sticking to it, and when your team delivers, is always a good thing for the captain. They're bringing in a spinner, Prem, now, but I think it's quite late. They should have done this, like, what, 5th over mark?
Possibly, but look, bringing in a spinner in a low-scoring contest is always fraught with danger. If the spinner can land it on the coin from the first ball, keep the batsman under pressure, well, good. On the other hand, if he lands a couple short or full and the batsman get hold of it, there you are out of runs as well. We have more people coming. And, well, some of the people are being encouraged to take up the mic for a few more commentary stints.
Well, I've got help for camera and scoring, so I'm going to do a little bit of a stint to allow Ajit to have a lot of water at this point in time. Prem comes in right arm, Kumaran goes behind the wicket and goes to the keeper, so that's a dot ball. Well, I still think they should have bought a spinner kind of earlier on. That's exactly what Kiviv did. The spinner brought their first wicket, and then that opened up the shelf for them. But yeah, every team is different. That's amazing bowling, though. A couple of deliveries from Prem, right on there.
Yeah, indeed. It will be really interesting how Savneet negotiates with the spinner. Right now we have Kumaran. And we see that the ball is getting past the batsman, faster than a usual flight spinner does. So that's an interesting way to negotiate this part of, the game.
I agree. The ball skids through. I mean, like Prem is sensible, hitting the right length. Well, I think this is a good thing from Kumaran as well. Having missed those three balls, just watching for it and getting a couple of them on the middle before really. We know what damage he can do when he goes on, right? All he needs is waiting for that one ball on his zone, and that's what he does. But let's see, where does it go? Anywhere on the fielders, anywhere close to the fielders? It was in between both the fielders, well positioned at the cow corner, and it's been a single for Kumaran. Puneet, you being a spinner yourself, how much of this do you like?
I like it a lot that the captain is trusting spinners to handle the situation. And the spinner who is bowling, he's mixing his ball with the flight balls as well as the balls that skid faster. And this mix is very difficult to play, I tell you. And this is where most batsmen make the mistakes.
Yeah, no wonder. I've made plenty of mistakes myself facing these bowlers, Puneet. It's really, really difficult. It doesn't look as easy as what you see. But I've thank my supporters over here. We've got Ajit in the commentary. He's been doing a fabulous job from yesterday. We've got Dilly over here helping us and making sure the setup is on. Puneet supporting us with commentary. Just couldn't resist watching it from home. And we have now been joined by Murali, who has taken over the scoring. And then we have the competition leader, Bart, over here, being prime support. And then we have the scorer from Centurions as well. So there's a lot of support that's going on. And the game of cricket is not just about 11 people playing there. Yeah. It's just the plenty of people at behind the scenes as well, isn't it?
Yeah, if you see the history of the game in the 1800s, it used to be a full-blown affair with families, etc., time for photograph sessions with the whole blazers on and then giving full time. And it used to be a complete family picnic, I would say.
I guess we can let go of one unsavory, let's say, story which is always involved with cricket. It was always started as a betting syndicate. They started cricket because some people wanted to earn money. Then came the playing, then came the families. But we'll park that for now. So the very first recorded instance of a player actually being booked for booking against or with his own team was a keeper who was supposed to go to Australia on the first ever tour in 1877. The English keeper who was supposed to go to Australia was caught booking or trying to make some money through results, and he was jailed. He couldn't go on the trip himself.
That was a very interesting piece of history that you brought in, indeed. In the meantime, we have from another end also, similar attack. And batsmen have been playing very sense. So Gurnam is from the other side. And, I'm seeing batsmen playing very sensibly this. So, it will be interesting how Centurions now make these batsmen play big shots and make those mistakes which spinners are used to trapping up.
Yeah, I sometimes wonder how do these guys make it look easy? He was bowling fast bowling just a couple of overs before, and then now he comes down, brings a spinner version of it, understanding that's what is working. And interestingly, we've been calling it out for quite a while to say that they should have bowled slow bowlers. But that's sheer quality from the bowler, right? To hold the ball different, to release it different.
The Ganga I had played against previously was always a spinner. I was actually surprised to see him open the bowling with medium pace. But normally, Ganga is always a spinner. And now I think he's gone back to his strengths.
I think the river flows in both ways at this point in time, Ajit. You guys played like, what, a decade before? Looks like he's gotten a lot more skills under his belt at this point in time. But this is a really smart thing from Centurions, not giving any pace to the batsman, bowling really slow. Is that going to be an inflicting run out? That's a good appeal. There was a very good dive by Savneet, saving himself. The hesitations within running of the wickets would cost a lot sometimes.
Yeah, we saw with the earlier wicket, I was telling to my friend that if you want to take singles inside the circle with just slow tapping, the person who is calling from the other end has can't fumble, can't take a chance even for for a slight stop. So in this case, Savneet were pretty confident to reach the attacking end, and he made it. So, but that brings us to the question that do we need these type of singles, and why a team should go for these types of singles? What's your opinion, Naveen?
Well, a couple of years before, I would have said don't do it. But the way that the game is being played in this time and era, I think they should definitely be taking them. But it's also a lot of understanding between both batsmen, right? There was a slight hesitation, probably less than a second, whatever, and that could have costed them. And that's what about partnerships and who you're playing with and how do you build trust between them, right? The more you would have run for the call, that would have seemed like a very, very easy one as well. But the best batsmen that I've seen over the years are batsmen who can run really, really quick, really, really rotate between and not wait for those big flamboyant shots.
Indeed. In comes Prem to start another over. This has been hoiked over the extra cover, and the man from long off is covering just a single. You know, as I said, bowling a spinner is always a double-edged sword. If you were to give it to a wrist spinner, you could end up with a full toss or two or a dragged down ball or two. There are two of this ilk in this commentary box who can tell you a thing or two about it. But nonetheless, bowling spin is always an attacking option with T20 these days. And another ball from Prem, right on length, that's been blocked back by Savneet.
Interestingly, I'm hearing that from a wrist spinner himself. Looks like he has bowled quite a bit of full tosses over the season, and hence that comes down. But that's the best part, right? Bad balls where spinners do get wicked sometimes, or most times.
You know, it depends on the kind of full toss people do. These days, a low full toss on the towards the leg side are getting wickets these days because batsmen, and unexpectedly, batsmen do not expect that, and they take it for a big juicy full toss and they make mistakes.
I think these overs, especially by Prem, I think he's bowled like 10 balls. He's given 2 runs, and that shows the importance of what a good spinner can do. He has kept both the batsmen around. He's just given singles. And that's really, really important balls that he's bowling at this point in time. Around about like 12th over mark, the only way for them to get any wickets is to make them hit on the air and make them score less and give them very less bad balls. And Prem is exactly doing what the team needs now.
And batsmen are resisting that temptation. I am seeing that also. So it's an interesting contest that we are seeing here. You know, pretty wonderful to watch.
A case in point, the previous delivery that was tossed up invitingly on the leg stump, but Kumaran was, happy to just block it back. So this is a very nice contest simply because we see another small period of consolidation from Kiwi, because this is the right thing for them. They have lost 5 wickets, but they know they have batting all the way. That means they can take a couple of overs, and as the total comes down right now, the score is 72 for 5, and we are 15 overs have been completed. Right, 13 overs have been completed. My apologies on that. So that means there's still plenty of overs left in the game.
Well, the required run rate is 2 runs an over, and it is very, very sensible by both the batsmen to not do anything more than what's needed at all. I think that's where cricket's glory comes in, when you really understand the match scenario and then go for it. These guys have got a lot of experience with them. That's one ball which was down shot, really played well by Savneet, pulled it down for a single. And that's all what you need. You need 2 runs and over. So why really do anything more than what's needed?
Yeah, exactly. As we earlier mentioned, that these batsmen, they have to resist the temptation for very long. and four or five overs is a long period in T20 to resist such a temptation.
I have a feeling very long is going to be very relative, because once the number of runs comes below 10, you're going to see one of these two going for two wickets in the end of the game. So meanwhile, Kumaran has comfortably cut this past point, and by the time cover fields, another run has been taken. So two runs have already come off three balls this over.
Interesting stats. I'm just quoting it from top of my head, so please verify if I'm right or not. Over the last 2.5-3 years, I haven't seen Centurions win against a QV. Is that fact right?
I'm not able to keep track of this. My apologies as well, because I've not looked up. But if that is the case, we hold a wood on them. We would really want this team to come in the final. As I was telling you, Savneet did not even wait for the total to come below 10. He got a juicy ball, a half volley, right in his half. And they had a very wide sort of a long on, sort of somebody who would cover also as a cow corner. And he just hit it straight off long on for a beautiful six.
So Rohit or any of the Team 1 players watching the stream, could you come on a WhatsApp group and leave us a comment? When was the last time that there was a win against QV versus Centurions where Centurions were winning? I've been watching for the last 2 years and I haven't seen it as far as what my memory goes, and I'd be very, very interested to know that.
Yeah, I don't know the statistics here, but right now, you know, on the game, I see that the fielding setting is not inviting the batsmen to actually, you know, to do more. So I am not sure what's the game plan. And the hit that you just saw was a clean hit by Savneet. It was not really to qualify as the spinner invited him, or, you know, so he is a ball on which someone can make a mistake. So barring that, Centurions, I'm not sure what's their game plan at the moment. What do you say?
Well, I think it's counting down as far as Kiwi are concerned. Indeed, I would have probably brought in a more enticing field, brought up more fielders, but you know, it's always a two-edged sword, because these both are clear hitters, clean hitters, and they both have shown they can hit clean. So even one miss hit can complete over the requirements. Getting a 4 or a 6, one hit, they can comfortably block the other 5. So it's sort of a in-out field, as it's called. Another short of length ball to Savneet, he's cut that behind point. While the man from deep point clears it up, there was a bit of confusion between the two batsmen. Kumaran has again had to dive back into his crease. He's again down, but this time he's getting up.
I'm sure one thing that Kumaran loves is to lie down either on the front of the back, sometimes on the ground. He does it really well when he does it. Another 5 runs to win. Another 5 or 6 runs to win. Well, QV were at 82 for 5. They need another 6 more runs to win the game. Prashant has been our photographer of the day. He has captured some amazing moments. Watch out on our Facebook group, QV. You guys will be able to see a lot more coming after today's game. But at this point in time, does it look like a done deal already, Puneet?
Now it looks like, unless someone does a Suresh for a hat trick, like we saw last time. Oh, that was a good try. In fact, great try. It's not easy to actually go back and take this catch. And we saw in ECN matches Vivek taking it twice. But barring that, we don't see that quite often, that bowlers are able to take that.
As expected, Kumaran tried to finish it off with a big hit. All he did was it went right up in the air. Now comes Prem once again. That's again a short of length ball, but there was only a short square leg whom Savneet had to beat, and he's done that comfortably. A powerful sweep shot. He's hit that right on top of the field there, and that's gone to the boundary, which brings us to within 2 runs of the victory. Within just 1 run of a victory, so the scores are currently tied. I think definitely it's been a wonderful contest. 5 wickets lost in the second innings as well in the chase.
Well, the scores are level. It was a good boundary swept through by Savneet to make the scores level. It's going to be interesting to see if they're going to do a glorious finish or a one-run end. But it really doesn't matter at the end of the day. It's been some amazing good performances by QVF today. Having come back from the power play overs where they left about 40 runs for no loss, And then taking the team for 87 all out shows some good quality. Centurions have been really great. They try to consolidate a lot, but it's been one-man show pretty much by Nyanavel on their banting rampant. But it's good finale. I think Rohit has got Samneet on fire on our messaging groups. So who's going to bowl the last over?
One thing I noticed that, you know, that as a T20 strategy, you have a great stat which, you know, Ashish and Maninder provided to Qweep. Then you have batsmen like Savneet. If you see Savneet's strike rate, it's almost 100. You know, 23 balls, 23 runs. But if you notice that most of the runs came from boundaries, so means the innings had a lot of dot balls. So you need to pace your innings well. And at the end, that scores the winning run.
That's the winning run by Kumaran. Qwave are the Laga Klasa champions for 2021. Amazing show by the team. Fantastic one. Proud to have played an opposition like Centurions in the finale. Great work by the umpires. Proudly supported by KNCB and helping us with the Frog Box stream. Competition leaders viewing what is happening down there as well. It's fantastic. Great weather, great game, and Qwave are the champions for 2021 on the Laga Klasa T20.
Indeed, a lot of excitement as you can expect on winning a competition. The players rush in, pick up a couple of stumps, which unfortunately they can't take home as souvenirs. We'll be collecting it back from them. There is another final coming up, the stumps will have to come back. We have Suresh making a guest appearance in front of the camera. Yesterday's hero of the second semi-final, who took a hat-trick, it must be said. Meanwhile, we are trying to arrange a couple of quick interviews with the winning team. So we've already captured some very good moments. Both teams, along with the umpires, participating in the finals of the Laga Klasa T20. Meanwhile, Prashant is again out there trying to capture some winning moments from Qweave. The two umpires. Having done their job, comfortably walking back. Meanwhile, you can hear the celebrations from Qweave. We would like to invite Maninder and a couple more players, Murad, Kumaran, to have a quick word.
The umpires are now walking down after finishing this amazing game. I hope they really liked seeing it. So the team is walking towards the stream. Thank you, umpires. It was a lovely game. Appreciate the support. Great umpiring for us. There we are. Jigs Jeeva. Probably we're going to see some jigs from Jeeva. No jigs down there. He's got it reserved for ECN, copyrighted probably. So there it is. The winning team comes down. Laga Klasa champions, Qwave 2021. Maninder, the captain, come on. Let's have a good conversation with you. Aja. Maninder.
Manu Punjabi boldi nahi andi. We'll do it in Hindi. So, Maninder, jeet ke kaise lag raha hai?
Bahut hi acha. Jabardast teamwork. बहुत ही अच्छा किया सबने, बहुत ही अच्छी बॉलिंग, बहुत ही अच्छी फील्डिंग, सुपर सुपर टीम वर्क.
वेल, फाइनल में इतना छोटा टोटल में उनको रिसीट करते हुए आपको पहले से लगा था कि आपने बॉलिंग करी?
हाँ, यही सोचा था कि उनको 100 के नीचे ले लें और बाद में हम अपना नेचुरल गेम खेल के आसानी से जीत जाएं.
अगर हम पूरे टूर्नामेंट की तरफ देखें, आपको क्या लगता है कौन आपके लिए अच्छे प्लेयर्स रहे हैं आपको खुद को छोड़ के?
मेरे लिए तो सभी अच्छे हैं. कभी हर मैच में एक अलग स्टार निकलता था और सभी अपने टीम वर्क के साथ जीते हैं. पूरा टीम वर्क किया.
सुन के बहुत अच्छा लग रहा है. आपको क्या लगता है आगे वाले आने वाले सालों में भी हम इस टूर्नामेंट को हमारे पास ही रखेंगे ट्रॉफी?
110%
कॉन्फिडेंट देख के बहुत खुशी हो रही है. एंजॉय करें आपके टीम के साथ.
We have Bart Kruse, the competition leader, proudly going to present the champions of the Lager Class of T20. Bart, please.
Probably think that you won the match fielding when Centurions was running away from you in the first couple of overs, and then you fought back at one over with three wickets, I believe. So that is, I think, where you won the game, and then sensible betting, losing maybe a few too many wickets doing so, but well, the last two batsmen were very sensible in taking the singles and waiting for the bat ball to hit it far away. This was the first year that we, as a KNSB, we organized a T20 competition for the lower classes. And basically, for me as a manager of the competition, it went out, well, so quietly. No disruptions, no bad behaviors, and that was very pleasing to see. Is that we are able to organize a competition that is played in midweek, in the evenings, making sure that our grounds are filled with cricket, and that's what we want as a KNSB. So we are going to expand on this. Hopefully, many more teams will follow your example by entering the competition, so that we can probably in more regions we can have this competition during weeks, and then hopefully next year be able to finish it off with a finals day where you will have semi-finals and a final. That would, I think, be brilliant, because then you will really have a festivity day, and that will be good for Dutch cricket. Well, then I want to ask the captain to come forward.
The captain of Lager Class of T20, Kiviv, Maninder Singh. Kiviv, champions for Lager Class of T20. The fun begins, the party begins for the team there. Some more. We've got Nitin, the chairman of Kiviv Cricket Club, congratulating the team down there for their amazing win on the finale. KNCB. Amazing one. There it is. This is a special moment. Manjit is presenting it to his daughter. That's lovely. That's beautiful moment to capture. Amazing work. Plenty of photographs coming your way, guys. That smiles makes it all.
You know, Naveen, you see players playing in the field, but it's the families also who sacrifice a lot during the cricket season. You will have to give it to the families also, you know, the whole season.
Absolutely. That's the fun about cricket, right? At the end of the day, it's going to be a lot of family sport. We got Richard's family down there, really far, probably preparing some stuff for them. And I'm going to not waste any more moment. Go join the guys and enjoy some photographs for myself as well, Puneet.
Thank you, Naveen. It was a pleasure commentating with you.